Professor Nezar AlSayyad is Professor of Architecture, City Planning, Urban Design, and Urban History. He is the Faculty Director of the Center for Arab Societies and Environment Studies, CASES, a faculty member of the Global Metropolitan Studies Group, the Urban Design Graduate Group, the International Area Studies Graduate Group, and the Middle Eastern Studies Undergraduate Program. For almost two decades, AlSayyad also chaired the Center for Middle Eastern Studies at Berkeley, leading to its international standing. Professor AlSayyad is educated as an architect, planner, and urban designer, and historian. He is principally an urbanist, and he is actually the chair of the IASTE and the editor of the Journal for the Additional Dwelling and Settlements Review. So I will leave the floor to Professor AlSayyad.
Well, again, I would very much like to thank the man for having invited me to this conference, as well as to thank Dr. Gaff for all of the arrangements that he made. I'm an architect and an urban historian who must have been among the first generation of scholars who dabbled with animation and computer simulation of cities, particularly of heritage sites, back in the late 80s and even early 90s. In fact, when Gamal invited me to come and be a speaker on this conference, I have to say I was quite reluctant since I have not really done this work for almost 15 years. However, I decided I would accept the challenge only because it gave me the opportunity to reflect on some of what I had engaged in as we were actually remembering this morning, 25 years ago, and frankly, what I have also totally abandoned in this last decade. Often in our life, our personal histories intersect with larger histories and encounters, and what I share with you today is simply an encounter with one of them. I was a student of Cairo University 40 years ago. I used to spend my weekends roaming around the streets of medieval Cairo and its mosques, climbing its minarets, navigating through centuries-old dust, historic debris, and sometimes even bats in some of these minarets. I cannot forget when I was once stopped by an old resident of the city, of Gamaleya particularly, who inquired if I was a foreign tourist. When I answered him that I was not, and that I'm just simply an architecture student, he persisted in asking me, why then are you carrying a camera? It was a strange thing for him that I'm carrying a camera, being an Egyptian. He continued to say, there's really nothing here for us anymore. It's all gone, it's all gone. Why don't you build us new buildings instead? That's what the guy said. I never really forgot this guy, and in fact, I returned several times to visit him until he actually finally died in 1982. Much of my research in the 1980s involved various projects to record the changes in Cairo's physical form and at its earliest days, in fact, to the present, in the hope of shedding some light on how Cairoans and others may have experienced the city throughout history. In the early 90s, this interest shifted to the use of computer simulation, which were generated by several collaborators, many of whom were my graduate students at the time, including, in fact, Dr. Lon Edison, who is here with us and who will speak later in the session. Stemming from my own personal conviction that as scholars, we have to make our knowledge accessible to a general audience and aim with a grant from the National Endowment for the Arts in the United States, I embarked on this specific project, which I called Virtual Cairo, with the prospect of producing a short documentary for public television. We were indeed the first to produce a computer simulation of Cairo in medieval times. My real challenge here was how to produce a video or a DVD of this sort without sacrificing the integrity of its culture. The DVD video was shown on several public television stations in the late 1990s, including in the IASTE conference in Cairo in 1998. And in fact, two or three of the attendees today may have even seen that video, which I'll show you later. So I apologize for those who have seen it almost 18 years ago. What you will see today is what we produced with technology that was available in the mid-90s, modified a bit with technology in around 2005-2006. It's the shorter version, it's only 25 minutes. The longer one was actually the standard public television program of 50 minutes. I will discuss the process that we used in making this particular project, both in terms of historical research and the making of the computer simulation itself. It is about the recording of urban change. So let's talk a little history. One of the most significant and less known aspects of Cairo's evolution starting from 969 AD was that it started as an orthogonally ordered royal compound. The Fatimids designated Cairo as a highly planned domestic grid with regular districts assigned to the various ethnic groups or tribes that made up the Fatimid army. Such an ordered and hierarchical urban scheme belied the stereotypical image of the Islamic city as an irregular, organic, labyrinthian entity as it's commonly known to be. How can a city, originally exhibiting such a strong formal order, evolve by the end of the Middle Ages to become the irregular city that we know today? The main street and central space of medieval Cairo has been the subject of much of my attention. That originally massive urban square was known as Bain of Historian, the one between the two palaces, a literal reference, in fact, to its location between the two original eastern and western Fatimid palaces of the city. For more than 1,000 years, this space has been rearranged, filled in, built up, and has, through each dynasty and under many rulers, served as an apt symbol of the city's dynamic character. Most recently, it was immortalized in the title of the 1956 novel, Palace Walk, Bain al-Qasrayn, one of the trilogy of Egyptian Nobel laureate Nadine Mahfouz that was set in that same area. We will actually see quite a bit of that in the DVD. One of the most significant periods of the history of Cairo's urban form commenced immediately after the end of Fatimid rule. The city of this time was described by two famous travelers, al-Baghdadi, of what is today North Iraq, and ElKasabany of what is today Morocco. What is remarkable is that although the two men appear to have visited the city, within only 45 years or so between each other, their accounts of the city was so fundamentally different. Writing in 1193 AD, al-Baghdadi noted that the city was characterized by large palaces, detached, handsome structures, and wide streets. While in 1243, Ibn Sa'id described the city as crowded, dirty, claustrophobic, filled with twisting irregular buildings and the dark alleyways. Well, faced with two such conflicting accounts, my first reaction was to assume that one of them was correct and the other one must have been wrong. The city could not have really changed so much in, you know, half a century. But after checking the contemporaneous accounts of other medieval cities in the Arab world by the two travelers, because they had also visited many cities in the Maghreb and many cities in the Levant, including Jerusalem, Aleppo, and Damascus, it occurred to me that it could not be the case. Something has changed in Cairo during that time. I have come to recognize that the change from the Shi'at Fatimid dynasty to the seemingly less despotic Sunni Ayyubids had unleashed a political process with significant urban consequences. Soliman, Salahuddin, and his descendants opened up the city to Cairo's residents, outlying districts, including the older settlement of Fustat to the south. Many of Cairo's urban poor started to take over the urban spaces that had formerly belonged exclusively to the rich and powerful groups associated with the Fatimid rulers, which is very interesting because it's a process that I would actually say is not at all different than what happens in Cairo today. It was a process of informal takeover, ashwa'iyat. Ashwa'iyat existed in Egypt 1,000 years ago as well. Even a lonely map of Cairo, which I started to construct, lacked, however, the third dimension that would allow me to record this transformation, even in a simple abstract manner. My first attempt to remedy the situation was by drawing detailed axonometrics, which you're seeing many of them here, of large urban complexes. Again, since these drawings were still executed in a two-dimensional domain on plain paper, they were limited in their power. I resorted, in this case then, to the making of clay models. Clay was a useful medium because of its malleability and suggestive qualities. The clay models allowed me to further analyze solids and void relationships and circulation patterns. And while they allowed us to envisage the overall feel of the city spaces, they could not capture the experience of being inside the medieval city. Clearly, no traditional architectural modeling technique was capable of depicting the city in the dynamic and animated way that computer modeling simulation promised. At least that's what we thought back in the mid-90s. Our effort aimed at constructing an abstract model of the city as it might have been in the late Fatimid era, around 1169, at the end of the era itself, as well as a more developed model showing how the city evolved and grew almost over four centuries later into Ottoman times. We started by constructing the city's buildings, building by building, block by block, as we knew them, like actually what you see partly here, and as you will see in individual buildings. But the idea of a model like that became so complex. So we decided to work on two models instead, and move chronologically forward and backward. Starting with a simple diagram of Cairo as its inception, adjusted to its current topography. We added buildings as time progressed to make the 1169 model. On the other hand, and starting in fact from a separate but equally abstracted model extracted from current maps, maps of Cairo in the 19th and 20th century, and using even some modern aerial photographs and figure ground diagrams, we moved backward, abstracted chunks that we removed to be able to arrive at the city of new times. We were running into two critical problems. The first was quite simple. Our models eventually became so complex and so unwieldy that they began to tax our computing power of the workstations. Of course, this was a very serious problem back in the 90s. I was telling some of my some of the guest speakers today that we crashed the entire system of the University of California a couple of times. Just simply to run the animation overnight. The second problem was actually more conceptual. And the second problem had to do more with our growing recognition of the futility of attempting to create a single complete model of historical change using fragments of historical evidence. It just simply doesn't work. We always knew that there was abundant information on certain buildings, but very little on the larger and dense urban fabric which constituted the entire built fabric of the city. In fact, this was a problem of levels of abstraction. Indeed, great detail could be used while simulating certain buildings, but there was little or no recorded information on the majority of the city blocks that surrounded it. While the disparity between the two conditions could not be easily bridged, we eventually remedied this disparity using fractal geometry. We analyzed the patterns of existing traditional neighborhoods, then we extrapolated various forms of residential areas that were no longer existing. And finally, we dropped these into the model as abstract urban blocks. Ultimately, we shifted our strategy and changed our concept of the modeling process from that of building a single mega model of the city to creating a database which included a number of different blocks and buildings at different levels of completion and resolution. The main benefit of this approach, creating a number of linked models of the historic city at different resolutions, was that our model was both usually always viewable and reasonably expandable. This phase of the making of the video or the DVD dictated the use of a storyboard, which is closer in nature to what is more commonly employed, if you will, in film than in architectural history, my field. To some extent, simulated historical reconstructions have to depend equally on the techniques of cinematic multimedia production and computer modeling tools, as well as standard historical architectural history methods. Historical construction of cities is both a difficult and a problematic practice. Because of the complexity of our historical knowledge, computer simulation was, for us anyway, a necessity, not simply a luxury. In fact, without the computer modeling aspect, this research project would not have been almost impossible, if you will, to visualize the information we managed to assemble. As architects and historians, we use computer modeling. We are becoming more and more aware of the nature, but also the limits of the computer simulation. This mode of visualization has the ability to depict physical form to an extraordinary degree of completeness. And that is what I would like to be able to reconstruct as an architect. However, as a historian, I rely on incomplete pieces of evidence from a variety of unequal sources. Sources for our work include archaeological evidence, textual descriptions by residents and travelers, records of documentations by city officials, like the muhtasibs of the medieval administrators, and the physical fragments of buildings that have survived until today. Most importantly, were artists' representations of individual buildings or of details of these buildings and renderings of spaces by specifically the Orientalist artists of the 19th century, which included people like John Frederick Lewis, Luigi Meyer, Amedeo Preziosi, John Triwick, David Roberts, and Jean-Léon Girard. You will also see how we managed to use some of these in the making of the project itself. And these are examples that come to us from Roberts. The sources of our disposal represented views from different time periods, embodied varying degrees of reliability, and were executed in different media. Using the and integrating all of them required a difficult balancing act. For example, paintings by the Scottish artist David Roberts that I'm showing you here, who actually visited Egypt between 1846 and 1849, and captured Ben of Osirian specifically, that main street of medieval Cairo, in some 30 watercolor and pencil sketches and oil paintings, were immensely useful. As part of our storyboard, they were used to create an animated sequence that simulated the street through the eyes of someone walking through it. The problem lay in the fact that Roberts, who was considered one of the most reliable 19th century painters of urban scenes, was depicting structures that were already 600 or 700 years old at the time that he visited the city. His images, regardless of how accurate, cannot be used as a factual portrayal of these structures from earlier times. Ideologically, we proceeded with the conviction that it is impossible to divorce thinking about past illusion-producing art, like Roberts, from our contemporary imaging modalities. So we always tried to corroborate most of the scenes we used by relying on depictions by different contemporaneous artists of the same space. We often alter these images digitally before we use them in the animation, sometimes in simple ways by enhancing their colors. Other times, the intervention was more serious, resulting in the elimination of building additions that disguise the original buildings or the forms of older structures. To avoid redundancy, I will illustrate this with only one simple example, which you'll actually see in the video. So for example, the image that you see to your left is actually one of those images that comes from one of these particular paintings. It's actually called the Love Token. We undertook the complicated task of qualifying these images after a closer examination of the artist's methods and their backgrounds revealed that the representation of street life was sometimes inaccurate, perhaps including images or symbols imported from other locations, not only outside of Cairo, but outside of Egypt altogether. As you would imagine, many of these Orientalist artists had actually visited other locations, and after a while, as a result of artistic license, they would borrow a detail that they may have seen in Italy, or in what is today Turkey, or in what is today Syria, and just simply pluck it on a building in Egypt. You see that actually here in the Love Token image, where the details that you have here, it's an impossible detail for one to actually argue as a detail that was in Cairo. We've never found a detail like this. So in a sense, one of the things that we would do is we would take the entrance of a building like this one, which is a true building, an existing building even in Cairo today, but then we would, in a sense, hybridize it with a detail like this that came from another building, if you will, from Cairo. The art historian Gerald Ackerman tells us, for example, looking at the work of this one, this comes from Jean-Louis Girard, the Love Token, which portrays almost a Romeo and Juliet-like balcony scene that never existed in Egypt. But he still tells us that Girard particularly was one of the most accurate painters in depicting the Cairene houses of Ottoman and Mamluk times. So when we decided to use this image, of course, we had to find a way to be able to qualify it for ourselves. Another better known example, of course, by Giro is the Snake Charmer, a beautiful painting that, in fact, ElKasabany used on the cover of his very famous book, Orientalism, because of the point it makes. It portrays a bunch of Arab bombs sitting in the portico of Cairo Mosque, being entertained by a dancing naked boy playing with a snake. I have to add here that Jerome, who was again considered the most scientific of his generation in depicting the Islamic Orient. So is Jerome documenting something that is reliable, that had existed? Well, indeed the snake charmer existed in 19th century Egypt and in Cairo. But it is unlikely that this could have been performed to the tunes of an immigrant Indian flute player, which that you see to the right, musician, and probably not to in a functioning mosque, and certainly not with a naked or nude boy. When you remove all of that stuff, you actually discover, no, it's not that bad, because you know this image still has resonance in what exists in Cairo today. This actually happens to be the Blue Mosque in what is today the Gulf of Aqaba. If you remove all of these things, then examination of the color allowed us, in fact, to know exactly not only which mosque this was, but how is it that this particular space could have functioned? Because of the telegraphy on the wall in this case, allowed us to reveal its origin. We did the same with this particular structure. Again, you see a bunch of people supposedly praying, except that you have another naked man. Why? Jerome just used to put naked people everywhere. So all we did was we continued to have this particular image without the naked man. When we wanted to illustrate how urban spaces were inhabited or filled with human activity, we resorted to filling them with actors involved in the typical tasks of the time. This too was a very difficult exercise, which required creating a database of people in different costumes, which actually we could authenticate, which is what is it that people were wearing. Much of it, of course, at that time was very cartoonish compared to what can be done today. This is another example. Again, it comes to us from John Young's painting, a beautiful one called Warm Day in Cairo. I could not locate this mosque. I tried very hard to find it. There was no mosque in Cairo that had a minaret that, if you will, came all the way to the ground. Ironically, when we just basically moved the minaret and put it on top, we could find the mosque. We could find a mosque that corresponded to this, although it's a mosque in ruins. Stylistically from Mamluk times. Now, I think what is very important here is to sort of remember that I played around with these amazing images of the Orientalist painters. It's an exercise that left me extremely uncomfortable. I believe that these images have such an artistic appeal and a power that can survive or withstand our use or even possibly our abuse, depending on how you feel about what we did. Indeed, I am consoled by what the ancient Greek historian Herodotus once said, and particularly about Egypt, and maybe somewhat jokingly, very few things happen at the right time or place. The rest do not happen at all. The conscientious historian will correct these defects, end quote. Perhaps that's what we did. Now, this is another image that I really love. It's actually, again, from Jerome. And it's from Jerome's, it's a painting called Prayer on the Roof, which as you know, people don't really play Prayer on the Roof. But of course, again, they're not facing Mecca. They're facing the opposite direction of Mecca. None of these things matter to Jerome very much. because his audience was, you know, his clients in Europe and in England. We must realize that even under the best conditions, the act of writing history consists of piecing together fragments. The process leads unavoidably to resolving contradictions between bits of evidence to arrive at a reasonably substantiated version of what may have occurred. We exercise judgment in qualifying which sources are more reliable than others. All these problems were compounded when we set to construct a computer model whose strength lies in its ability to make precise alternative historical depictions of urban form and space. But by accepting a greater level of abstraction and deliberate repetition of recurring patterns, we think we were able to reproduce or reduce the inherent arbitrariness of our extrapolated forms. The final part hopefully corresponds better to the totality of what was medieval Cairo. As historians, we should come to terms with the potential of this new technology and its use in our research. And again, I say that from the perspective of someone who started much of this activity some 25 years ago. But we should equally resist the seductive power, its seductive power, and at least our ability to produce models of historical context that exceed our knowledge of the built environment based on available resources. The architectural desire to produce even more realistic models may result in the legitimation of historical depictions based on little more than speculation and the demand of the computer to assign all objects absolute coordinates. Paradoxically, and as we contemplate future use of these super accurate computers, we have to learn to tame our inherent insistence on a singular or an absolute truth or narrative. For the truth exists only in the mind of the beholder. We have built up a city around words, that's why I leave that slide to you. In the beginning, there was the word, and now it is hopefully not only the word. We must remember that the writing of history is first and foremost an art of interpretation, not a science of representation. The story of Cairo that we are about to see changes from time to time and place to place to reflect the interests of those who tell it, as much as the expectations of the people for whom it's told. The challenge in using this medium is telling the history, in telling this history, will perhaps be in reversing the equation and finding the proper balance between what I consider the art of interpretation on the one hand and the science of representation on the other. I hope you enjoy this shorter version of Virtual Cairo that we will show now in DVD form. It's also historic in its own right, since it has been produced, as I said, almost 20 years ago, with minor updates that were made in 2006, so as to speak much of the history of virtual construction, as it does for the history of Cairo itself. In the end, let me just say that I believe that what we have done is not very much dissimilar to what the great Renaissance artist and recorder Giambattista Veronese did in his famous etching, The Apian Way. In this etching, he systematically unearthed the remains of Italian antiquities and placed them in miniaturized manner between the covers of heroically scaled albums. Different times call for different measures, using the less poetic but more populist video DVD format instead. I believe we have performed a similar representational rescue work. But unlike that of Veronese's, ours does not possess the immunity bestowed by the passage of time. In this work, I have tried to let the multiple histories of Cairo present their own multiple meanings, but I'm very conscious of how these in turn are meshed in the politics of representation of which I am a part. Since I operate mainly in the space between the words and the images, I am perhaps another Baudelairean flaneur whose eyes have wandered around the city in search of himself. The great novelist Calvino once wrote, "Cities are like dreams, their rules absurd, their perspective deceitful, and everything conceals something else. We take the light, not in a city's 7 or 17 wonders, but in the answer it gives to a question of ours, or in the question it asks of us in return. Thank you very much.